This video deals with concept of nursing unit. Here we discuss physical layout and its necessary facilities. This is the beginning of unit 2 as per KUHS syllabus for nursing students. Already we have completed unit 1 and the complete videos are available in the playlist of this channel. Before going to the detail of the topic, let us see the KUHS previous question asked from this area. The question is, enumerate 4 types of wards. It is for 4 marks. It was asked in the year October 2016. Let us begin our topic, the concept of nursing unit. The concept in the design and the facilities of a nursing unit has been changed time to time based on the categories of patients and the peculiarities of nursing care. There are different categories of patients and their nursing care is also different. So according to these factors, that is categories of patients and according to their nature of nursing care, the concept in the design and facilities of nursing unit have changed from time to time. In a hospital, the nursing unit is broadly classified into two. They are general nursing unit and special nursing unit. General nursing unit is defined as unit wherein patients are kept without any special requirement or consideration. In general nursing unit, patients are there and they don't have any special requirement or consideration. Whereas in a special unit nursing unit, there are patients with extraordinary requirements. Here, the patients are grouped due to their age, gravity of illness, etc. Examples of special nursing unit include intensive care units, emergency care units, pediatric units, obstetric unit, orthopedic units, etc. In this type of special care unit, patients are grouped into or grouped according to their age, gravity of illness or many other factors, and also these patients have extraordinary requirements. Whereas in a general nursing unit, they don't have any special requirement or consideration. Coming to the meaning of nursing unit. Nursing unit is otherwise called a ward. How we can define the term nursing unit? It is defined as a section of a hospital that includes a nursing station, the beds it serves and the necessary services, storage area, work and public areas needed to carry out the nursing care. So a nursing unit is a section of a hospital. So this section have or this section should have nursing station, the bed it serves and necessary services, storage area, work and public area needed to carry out nursing care. So such a section is called a nursing unit. The features of nursing unit. First one, most of the equipment and staff is housed in this area. Second, all the medical care, teaching and research are concentrated in this area. Third, it serves as a temporary home for patients because they stay in the unit for days, weeks or even months together. It must be designed in accordance with the social needs and habits of the dependent community, that is patients. It should provide for best of physical facilities and optimal work, which result in high quality nursing care. It should be operated at lowest possible cost and provide congenial environment for nursing and medical staff to work. Coming to the purposes of a nursing unit. A nursing unit should have 5 important purposes. They are enhance the nurse-patient interaction and to provide high standard of nursing care. Enhancement of nurse-patient interaction and provision of high standard nursing care. That is the first purpose of establishing a nursing unit. Second, maximize the efficiency of operation and ability of nurses working in the unit. Third, reduce the nurses' fatigue factor. Fatigue factor means the tiredness produced by unwanted walking inside a nursing unit. So, while constructing the nursing unit itself, this factor has to be considered. That means avoid unwanted walking by nurses and other caregivers. Fourth purpose is meet the functional requirement of the hospital, thereby enhance the administrative efficiency and economy. And the fifth and the last purpose is provide for better material handling. Next section is about the type of nursing units. The quality of patient care and the smoothness of ward function depends on the design, type and location, physical facilities, physical layout, and the amount of equipment and supplies provided in a nursing unit or ward. The first factor that you have to be considered in categorizing a nursing unit is its size. The limiting factor in the size of the nursing unit or ward unit is the capacity of the head nurse to supervise. So, the size of a nursing unit or the size of a ward is determined by the capacity of the head nurse or the caring nurse to supervise the patients. According to Florence Nightingale, or Florence Nightingale recommended a 30-bed ward. Florence Nightingale recommended a 30-bed ward, and until now the same limit is more or less being followed. So a ward or a nursing unit is the maximum bed strength is 30-bedded. So that is the capacity, that is a maximum capacity for a nurse to supervise. In an acute ward with rapid turnover, the upper limit is definitely 30. Then two or three such units are located on the floor with certain common essential areas in the middle. So the first factor in categorizing the type of nursing unit is the size. According to Florence Nightingale, or Florence Nightingale recommended a 30-bed ward. The same thing is followed now, even nowadays also. So a 30-bed ward means that is a maximum capacity of the nurse to supervise. The second factor that we have to consider in categorizing a nursing unit is its shape. According to the shape, there are 12 types of wards. First one, Nightingale ward. Second, single corridor ward. Third, L-shaped ward. Fourth, T-shaped ward. Fifth, racetrack ward. Six, cruciform unit. Seven, Rigs pattern. Eight, cross shape unit. 9, circular unit. 10, triangle unit. 11, cluster unit. And 12, radial unit or ward. In the beginning of this section, we have seen a question that is enumerate 4 types of ward. Here you have the answer. Out of this 12, you can mention any 4 wards with its definition if possible. The first type of ward according to the shape is Nightingale ward. Look at this picture. See, this is a rectangular type ward or open plan ward. Here there is 2 rows of bed, one row here and the other row here. The nurses are located, or the nursing station is located in between the 2 rows of bed. The necessary support services for the patients are placed on two end of the unit. This is one end and this is the other end. Support services are placed on two ends of the rectangular ward. See this picture. The nurses on duty are seated in the middle in between the two rows of bed. This is one row and this is the other row. This is the rectangular type ward. Coming to the description, this type of ward is established by Florence Nightingale. This is an open plan ward. As we have seen in the picture, this is an open plan ward and there is 25 to 30 bed. The services for patients are located at either end of a long rectangular ward like this. The staff supervision is in the aisle between two rows of bed. Here is the staff. They are located in the aisle between the two rows of bed. And this is the noisiest type of ward. The second type is the single corridor ward. Here you can see Patient room are aligned along a corridor and are often face each other. This is the patient room. This is the other row for patient room. They face each other, and in between there is a single corridor. And on one side there is different patient support services, and the opposite side there is nurse's station. This is single corridor pattern. Third type is L-shaped ward. In this picture you can see this is L-shape. Here the patient rooms are located on both arms of L. This is one arm, this is the other arm. You can see both arms there are patient rooms. And this is the junction of these two arms. And here is the area where support services are located. And it is near to the entrance. This is the entrance. The patient beds are located on two arms of the L. The support services and the staff are at the junction. This is the junction where support services, and this is the placement of ward or the location of patient rooms. The staff and the supervision are concentrated at the entrance, like here, with the minimum penetration into the patient area. Since the entrance is here, there is minimum penetration into the patient area. The fourth type of ward is called a T-shaped ward. Here, the support and supervision are concentrated at the vertical arm, and the patient areas are located on the horizontal arm of T. This is the T. This is the horizontal arm. This is the vertical arm. Here you can see the patient room or the patient areas are located on the horizontal arm of T, and the support services are located on the vertical arm of T. The fifth type is called a raised track. In this type of ward, the patient areas are laid out at the periphery of a deep rectangle, and the services and the staff areas are in the middle. The patients are given a view, but the staff has no view. The staff has long distances to travel, and communication between them is difficult. In this picture, you can see this is a deep rectangle. So, the patient areas are laid out at the periphery of this deep rectangle. This is the patient area. This is at the periphery of this deep rectangle. The support services are located in the middle of this deep rectangle. Then, the patients are given direct view. This is the placement of the staff or nursing staff. So, the patients are given direct view. But, the staff has no view. Then they have to travel long distances, and the communication between them is very minimum or it is difficult. The sixth type of unit is cruciform unit or cruciform plan. Here, the patient room comprises a peripheral arrangement. The support areas are laid at the intersection of arms. This form results in a lot of cross traffic. It is used in double wards, where there are two separate ward units but only one set of supervisory staff. In this picture you can see it has the shape of a cross with two arms. This is the vertical arm and this is the horizontal arm. And the periphery of this cross, you can see the placement of patient area or the location of patient area or ward. Then, at the intersection, this is the area of intersection of two arms, you can see the support services. And this area creates lot of traffic. And it is used in double wards. This is one ward and this is the other ward, where there is two separate wards but only one set of supervisory staff. Seventh type, Ribs pattern. The nursing unit has been divided into small cubicles for 1, 2, 4 and 6 beds. The beds are arranged parallel to longitudinal wall. The pattern was first built in Rick's Hospital, UK, and it still bears the same name. This is a picture of Rick's pattern. This is one cubicle and this is the other cubicle. Each cubicle has 1, 2, 4 or 6 beds and with the nurse's station. This is another picture. This is one cubicle, other cubicle, another cubicle like that. The cubicles face each other and the nurse's station is located here. This is a close view of a patient cubicle in RICS ward. About the disadvantages of this ward, there is difficulty in communication between the nurse and the patient because they are located or they are placed in the cubicle. It also reduces the visibility and observation of the patient by the staff. The wards become longer and consequently the nurse has to work more and it increases the number of nurses who are required on duty. These difficulties can be overcome by installing calling bell, signal light or closed circuit TV. Also, to reduce the walking distance, there may be or this RICS pattern may be redesigned into T, E and Y shape or with a double corridor. About the eighth type, that is the circular unit. The circular configuration of the 1970s shortened travel path for nurses but limited the potential for architectural adaptability. It also meant inadequate support space and storage. Here you can see this is a circular pattern of patient unit configuration. This is the center of the circle where nurse station and other support services are placed. Here this color represents the arrangement of bed, that is at the periphery of the circle. This was designed in 1970s. Its advantages are short travel path and good visibility of patients. But it has inadequate support space and storage and limited potential for architectural adaptability. This is the other picture showing the circular placement of patient bed. This is a circular arrangement and this is the nurse station. The ninth type is triangular unit. The triangles of 1980s again shortened the travel path but limited support space and storage. This is the triangular pattern. This is the area where patient beds are placed. And in the center of the triangle, there is nurse station and here is the entrance and support services. It was designed during 1980s and it minimizes the travel path. But it has limited support space and storage. This is the other picture of triangular pattern. This is the patient rooms and this is the placement of nurse station and this is the entrance. The 10th type is clustering of unit. Patient clusters of 1990s promoted the perception of nurse isolation from other caregivers. This is the clustering of patients. This concept came out during 1990s and this is the entrance. And here you can see the placement of nurse station, which faces clusters of patients. This nurse station care this clusters. This one for this cluster of patients and this is for patients who are located in this area. So there is isolation. There is no communication or no connection between the nurse station for this cluster and as well as this cluster. So it promoted the perception of nurses' isolation from other caregivers. The 11th pattern is called as radial layout. This layout typically allows visibility from the central nurse station to all patient rooms. No physical barriers block visibility of patient rooms from central nurse station. One side of corridor is attached to nurse station at all times. This is the image. This is the centralized nurse station and just opposite to nurse station, there is support service. Then around nurse station, around the centralized nurse station, the patient rooms are arranged. So the nurses are able to visualize the patients at all times. Or no physical barriers block the visibility of patient room from the centralized nurse station. And this is the last type of nursing care unit according to the shape. You can mention any four of these shapes in your answer booklet if this question is asked in the examination. Coming to the special types of wards. Additional accommodation or differences in size and shape include intensive care ward, infectious disease ward, etc. Already we have seen in intensive care ward or infectious disease ward, patients with the extraordinary requirements are admitted. So there is additional accommodation and differences in size according to the type of patients admitted in special care units or wards. About prerequisite of a nursing unit. To work effectively in the ward, there are certain prerequisites. It includes physical layout of the unit, equipment and supplies of the unit, and third, staffing of the unit. First, about the physical layout. The physical layout of the nursing unit should be planned and built in such a manner so that it helps the head nurse or the nurse manager to discharge her duties and carry out her responsibilities efficiently. The physical layout consists of primary accommodation, ancillary accommodation, and sanitary accommodation. In the primary accommodation, there is patient rooms or bedrooms. It consists of single bedrooms or multiple bedrooms as we have seen in cubicles. For planning purposes, 120 square feet per bed is allowed. If it is a one bedroom cubicle, the space should be 120 square feet. Two beds 180 square feet, four bed 330 square feet, six bed 400 square feet. That should be the size of the bedrooms. The next primary accommodation, the next facility is the treatment room. The treatment room should be in every nursing unit to carry out surgical dressing, basic and advanced nursing procedures, etc. This should reduce the risk of infection. Every nursing unit should have a separate treatment room to carry out different types of nursing procedures. That is the second requirement in primary accommodation after the patient rooms or bedroom. The third requirement is nurse's station or nursing station. The nursing station should be raised in order to have uninterrupted vision of patients. The nurse's station should have the following components: a sister's room or nurse manager's room with attached bathroom and wash counters, cupboard for medicines and dangerous drugs, a large work table in open space with chairs for carrying out daily work, patient nurse call device, and telephone services. The fourth requirement of primary accommodation is medical officer's room. It should have couch for examination of patients, desk, chair, and wash basin. About the nurse's room in the primary accommodation, it should be provided with the facility for changing into hospital uniform and should be attached with a toilet. There should be provision for cupboards, table, and few chairs and shelf for keeping their clothes and taking their meals. Clean utility room. It is used for storage of IV fluid, CSST articles, dressings, instruments, dressing drums, sterilizers and so on, and also it is used for setting up trolley or tray for various nursing procedures. About the stores, it is for keeping the linen and bulk supply of cleaning materials. And last, the laboratory. A ward laboratory or a clinical side room to perform routine blood, urine and other tests by house surgeons and intern for quick results. These are the requirements of primary accommodation in the physical layout. We are discussing about the physical layout. In the physical layout, there is primary accommodation that we have completed already. Then coming to the ancillary accommodation. The first ancillary accommodation is ward kitchen or pantry. If the food is received from central kitchen, the tray is prepared for serving in the ward or common dining hall from the ward kitchen or pantry. Next facility in the ancillary accommodation is day room. It is for meeting the recreational facility of the patients admitted in the unit, and it should be comfortably furnished room. Next is conference hall. Conference hall should be or should have LCD projector with a wall mounted screen. And the last facility in the ancillary accommodation is stretcher or trolley bay. It is a place where trolley or stretcher and wheelchairs are placed. Coming to the sanitary accommodation. First one, dirty utility room. It is provided for cleaning, bedpan, urinal, sputum mugs, etc. It should be fitted with the racks for bedpan, urinals, bottles, sputum mug and all other facilities. There should be provision for sink or washer and free supply of hot and cold water. It should be located near bath and wash counter annex. About bath and wash counter facilities in the sanitary accommodation. One urinal for 16 beds. One wash counter for 8 beds. One bathroom for 12 beds. One hand wash basin for 10 beds. And a janitor's room for keeping cleaning materials and buckets. Coming to the other facilities, it includes supply of cold and hot water, piped gas for heating purpose, electrical outlets at convenient sites, call system, telephones, clocks, and lighting of wards and treatment areas. We are seeing the prerequisite of a nursing unit. We are discussing the prerequisite under three headings: physical layout, equipment and supplies, and staffing. About the physical layout, we have completed. Now we will see about the equipment and supplies of a nursing unit. Nurses who are aware of location of equipment and supplies do give accurate delivery of patient care and avoid wastage of time and energy for collecting the equipment. The equipment and supplies of a patient unit consist of bedhead unit, logistic support, resuscitation room equipment and kitchen equipments. The bedhead unit consists of lighting unit, central oxygen and suction pipeline, calling system, monitoring equipments, communication equipments, fire and safety equipments, BP instruments wall mounted, inverters, hospital furniture and appliances, stretchers, trolleys, wheelchairs, bedside lockers, bedside lamps, movable screens, hand wash stands, instruments, bedpans, and waste bins. Coming to the logistic support, it includes linen and laundry, CSST items, medical equipments, surgical equipments, and sterilizers. Dressing drums, tray for nursing procedures, trolleys, articles for comfort measures. The resuscitation room should have life-saving emergency equipments, drugs and supplies, oxygen outlets, medical air outlets and suction outlets. Kitchen equipments includes crockery and cutlery, refrigerators, juice maker, microwave, LPG and stove. Under equipment and supplies of a unit, the last category is biomedical waste disposal articles. It includes different colored dustbins used for collection of biomedical waste. Yellow, red, blue, black. The third prerequisite of a nursing unit is staffing. What is staffing? It is the number and composition of nursing personnel assigned to work in a nursing unit at a given time. At a particular point of time, several numbers of nursing personnel and several categories of nursing personnel are required to do different types of work. So, the number and composition of nursing personnel in a unit at a time is called as staffing. This helps the head nurse to visualize the equitable distribution of nursing personnel in the unit. It serves as a guide for planning daily, weekly, and monthly schedules.
For the summary of this video, so far we have discussed about the concept of nursing unit first, then discussed about meaning of nursing unit. After that, we have seen the five purposes. Then we have discussed about the different types of nursing unit according to the size and shape. About the shape, we have seen 11 designs, and these 11 designs, the four you have to mention as the answer of the university question we have seen in the beginning of this video. After discussing the types, we have moved into the prerequisites of nursing unit under physical layout, equipment and supplies, and staffing. Here is the end. Thanks for watching and patient listening. Please subscribe and share.